Sunday nights, we're in a study of the history of Israel. And when I say that, I'm not simply talking about a people. I am talking about a people, but I'm talking about a nation within a border or within a boundary. Now, when we think of Israel, we think of the Jews. And of course, the word Jew comes from Judah. And Judah was the southern kingdom. Judah was the fourth son of Jacob. Of course, Jacob's name was changed to Israel. And out of Judah would come the king. And we're talking about the books of the kings. When you go into the Septuagint, when you see LXX, that's 70. That's what that means, 70 in Roman numerals. Well, when you see that in a religious writing, it means Septuagint. Septuagint, or is it G-E-N-T? Septuagint was the first translation of any of the Old Testament Masoretic text into the Greek language. That was translated a couple of hundred years before Christ came, and that was so that the people in the world who spoke mostly a Greek language, they would be able to understand the Old Testament, since the Old Testament had become a dead language, not completely dead. The Pharisees, who had once been the rabbis in the Babylonian synagogue, had deified that language and reserved it for students and scholars in the synagogues or in the temple in Jerusalem. Now, we're talking about the books of the kings. And the books of the kings in the Septuagint, when you go into the Septuagint, the books of the kings, you've got, when we say kings, we think of 1st and 2nd Kings. But the books of the kings is 1 Samuel, 2 Samuel, 1st and 2nd Kings, 1st and 2nd Chronicles. The book of the kings is 1 Samuel through 2 Chronicles. That's because it is a life and picture of Israel as a kingdom from Saul, the first king, unto Zedekiah, the last king of southern Judah. And of course, God was the first king. The reason Israel is called kingdom of God or kingdom of heaven, about 200 years before Christ, the rabbis dropped the word God and inserted the word heaven so as not to offend the Jewish people. They dropped, and anytime you'll see them, they'll put G-D because they don't want to bring reproach upon that name in the English language. Of course, the name of God is not G-O-D, God. God is an office, G-O-D. Let me just say this, God. God is an office, because when you define the word God, God is the word Elohim, E-L-O-H-I-Y-M in the Hebrew. It is the word theos in the Greek, and they both mean the same thing. They mean a magistrate, or a judge. A magistrate or a judge is an office, is a position. And when we say God, and people say, what about Trinity? What does Trinity mean? Well, Trinity, the word Trinity is not in the Bible, but the concept is in the Bible. And especially in 1st John 5 and 7, there are three that bear record in heaven, the Father, the Word, and the Spirit. The word Trinity means three in one, is what it means. And one God, and I've said before, it's not God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit, because if it were that way, they would be three gods. What it is God is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, the judge. If I said this before, if you have a little town and you've got one judge, you have a city judge, and you got three men that serve on that, if they could have the exact same mind, this is how they would do. God is the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Three different persons, but one judgeship, and they all serve the same, and they all agree. These three agree in one, the Scripture says. So, I don't know how I got there. G-D. That's the way they would write that. Kingdom of heaven, kingdom of God are one and the same. Matthew, the 5th chapter of the Bible said, blessed are the poor in spirit, theirs is the kingdom of heaven. In the 6th chapter of Luke says, blessed are the poor in spirit, for theirs is the kingdom of God. This was an old ancient term for Israel. The 12th chapter of 1 Samuel tells us that God was the king of Israel before they said, give us a man to be king. God said, I'll give you a man. I'll give you the wrong man. He said, I'm your king. You don't want me as king? He picks out a man that's tall and handsome and strong, and he looks like a guy. If there's anybody that looks the part, it's this man Saul. But God picks him out, and he tells Samuel, I've given you a captain over Israel, and it will be this Saul from the tribe of Benjamin. So when God picks out Saul, he picks out the wrong tribe. So in the 15th chapter of 1 Samuel, when Saul doesn't execute the fierce wrath of God against Amalek, and he doesn't go down there and kill all the sheep, he brings back some good sheep, and he brings back Agag the king, and Samuel goes up to him and says, I thought God told you to utterly annihilate Amalek. These Amalekites tried to waylay the Israelites 700 years ago when they were coming out of Egypt, and Israel had no defense, and they were a bunch of barbaric people, just killers and marauders. God said, I want them dead. Well, of course, Saul brought back some of the good sheep, and he did not do the work of God. And so God says, for that, he said, I've taken the kingdom from you. Of course, the first thing Saul said there in that 15th chapter, 1 Samuel, he said, but I'm just the king. The people wanted to offer sacrifice to God, and so they brought back these sheep. I'm just the king, and I can't control the people. Saul did everything he wanted to do, and of course, that's when Samuel uttered those famous words, it is better to obey than sacrifice. God doesn't need your ritual. And then that's when the scripture says that it repented God that he made Saul king. Well, repent doesn't mean he found some church and cried down an aisle and went, I'd like to repent, I made Saul king. Repent meant to turn. He had to turn from making Saul the king, but when he chose Saul, he knew he had already planned his turn because Saul was from the tribe of Benjamin, not the tribe of Judah. And of course, he tells Samuel, go down to the house of Jesse in Bethlehem, Judah. I have chosen me a king among his sons. And he went down there, and he caused seven of the sons of Jesse to pass before him. And he said, is not one of these, Jesse. He said, do you have any left? He said, there remaineth yet the youngest. Behold, he keepeth the sheep. And he tells one of the boys, go get David. And when David walks into his presence, he says, that's him. And of course, David is anointed there in the 16th chapter of 1 Samuel as king. And Saul, in the eyes of the people, was king to the 31st chapter till he was killed at Mount Gilboa. And David is the king in the eyes of God to the end, Saul in the eyes of the people. Of course, we've been going through these kings and talking about these kings. And there's something we must realize. If we are going to learn anything about the Bible, anything, prophecy, you're going to understand the 70 weeks of Daniel. You're going to understand the spirits in prison. You're going to understand prophecy. If you're going to understand the covenant to Abraham, there's a section of the Bible that is as imperative to know as any part of the Bible. I would say more so. More so than any other section of the Bible, you need to know what's going on between 1 Samuel and 2 Chronicles, because in Deuteronomy 28, God says, if you follow me, says the same thing in the 26th chapter of Leviticus, in the 15th chapter of Exodus. He said, if you keep my statutes and my commandments, he said, I'll bless you in all these ways and you'll conquer all your enemies. But if you go against my statutes, I will send judgment. I'll send the sword, the famine, the pestilence, and the beast. That's the world system to carry you into captivity. Well, if you don't do that, during your reign, I'm going to bring you back to the land that I gave to Abraham, and these are the promises I'm going to make you. Well, who is it that's going to lead Israel into righteousness or unrighteousness? It will be the king of Israel. And as long as they had a righteous king, mattered not where Israel stood as a whole, God would make that king win. It's just like when Saul was king in the eyes of the people, there in the 15th chapter of 1 Samuel, and the Lord tells Samuel to go down to the house of Jesse in the 16th chapter, and David comes out as a little shepherd boy, and he wasn't a skinny little guy like this. You had to be 20 years old or older to serve in Israel's armies. That's why when they were in the wilderness, God said, we'll kill everyone from 20 years old and upward. That was of military age and older, because they were unwilling to go in and attacked the Anakims when they came to Kadesh Barnea. I'm bringing out to say this. David was probably very wiry, probably about 17 years old, but he was too young to be in the army. But he had honed the skill with that sling. If you'll remember, those slings, I used to make slings when I was a kid back in the 40s, and I'd take two long strips of leather and I'd take a shoe tongue out of an old pair of shoes. And if you would take that sling, you had to get real smooth, round stones if you expected that thing to go straight. If you took a piece of rock, I learned this early, and it had jagged edges on it, and you threw it, it would go like that, like some guy throwing a spitball, except it would just go crazy when you threw it. Well, those shepherd boys, they became so adept with the sling. In fact, the tribe of Benjamin, the 12th son of Jacob, the tribe of Benjamin, the scripture says they were so good with the sling, they could hit a hair's breadth at the distance that they could throw it. 50, 75 yards away, they could hit a hair's breadth, and they had an entire company of nothing but men with slings. And those shepherd boys all day long would be out there, and they would be throwing, practicing constantly. In fact, they used the sling if the sheep were fairly close, and one would get a little far away, they would take that rod. The rod was the way they would make the rod, they would take a tree. They had a rod, they had a staff. Thy rod and thy staff, they comfort me. And they had a sling. That was their main weapons of defense and of rescuing the sheep. Well, they would take a small tree and they would dig it up and they would shave off the knob of the root as it went into the ground. It would be kind of a big thing and have a knob come down it, and they'd put hobnails in it. And what they would do, they used this to, if a sheep got just a little bit far, they would throw it right beyond the sheep and the sheep would scare them and come back this way. They'd use that rod to count the sheep as they came in at night. They'd count them and tap them on the head just as they came by. 1, 2, 3. And they knew exactly how many they had. And then they would use the rod when David went out against Goliath and he said, I've killed a bear and I've killed a lion. A skinny little 12-year-old boy couldn't do that. He meant, with this rod, I grabbed a lion by the beard and beat his brains out. He was trying to eat my flock. That's why he said, I haven't proven your things. I haven't proven this armor that you've got, Saul. And I was bringing the point out. He wasn't a kid. He had honed his skill with that sling, and he had honed his skill with that rod, and he said, I can hit that giant Goliath right here. I can hit him right there. I'm real good with this. It wasn't some miracle. David's skinny. He's going, you know. And he slings that, and God goes, let me throw that rock at him. David was good with it. And he knew that he could. He's the lumbering, big old lumbering guy that stomping around like that. David said, he's not going to get close to me. I'll hit him right there with it. And here's the point I was bringing out. If David had, when he went down there and Saul was king in Israel, who was king in Israel? No, who was king in Israel at the time David went down to fight Goliath? Huh? Wait a minute. What do you mean? David is anointed in the 16th chapter. He was already king in the eyes of God when he went down to fight Goliath. That's the only reason Israel won. If Saul had been king, as evil as he was, God would have had the Philistines just beat their brains out down there. David was the king. Because he was king, they were going to win. They just didn't know he was king. They might have thought that Samuel came down there and did some hocus pocus on us. So David is king. As long as these kings, as long as they followed the will of God, then God said, you will win. You'll go against your enemy one way and they will flee seven ways. It does not matter how big the army is. If you'll remember in the 20th chapter of 1 Kings, when Ben-Hadad, this king of Syria, comes down to attack northern Israel, and the king of northern Israel at that time, does anybody remember who he was? When Ben-Hadad came down there and he said, I demand an unconditional surrender of northern Israel, and I want all your women,
I want all your gold and everything you got.
God had an evil king in Israel at that time. Ahab. Yeah. It was Ahab. He said, God said, I don't like what Ahab's doing. I'll take care of him. But this makes me mad when Ben-Hadad demands the unconditional surrender of Israel. And God said, told a prophet, he said, go tell Ahab there's only 7,000 men in Israel that can fight, and there's hundreds of thousands of these Syrians, and they covered the plain like grasshoppers. He said, prophet, go tell King Ahab, I want him to give the order to attack. And Ahab's going, huh? Who's going to give this order? The prophet said, you. And they went out and camped against these. And what really made God mad was they said, the Syrians, they went out against them first in the hills, and the Israelites just whipped them right and left. And they said, your God is the God of the mountains. You can't do that out on the plain. God said, you made me mad now. He said, go out against them, Ahab. Well, here's the Syrians covering the plains. And Israel goes out there and encamps against them, and they're like two little flocks of kids, two little flocks of goats, and they're going, boy, they're everywhere. And Ahab says, attack! And they killed 100,000 that day. They had 7,000 in Israel. Now, God will make his exceptions. The only reason he made the exception with Ben-Hadad, the king of Syria, is because he demanded. Now, when God wants to take vengeance on Ahab, he does that, and he has him die in battle in that 22nd chapter of 1 Kings because he's a godless man. Now, we've gone through these kings. We went through Saul and David and Solomon, how Solomon started off in his early life, a wise man, a humble man, a goodly man. And then he asked God for wisdom, and then he gets into his middle age in the 11th chapter of 1 Kings, and he lets his 700 wives and 300 concubines. First of all, he doesn't need to be marrying 700 wives and 300 concubines because Nehemiah, the 13th chapter, said these strange women turn the head of Solomon. And that will turn the head of any man when you intermarry with a lie, with these sun worshipers. Well, of course, God said, I'll split the kingdom for that because of Solomon. And he split it through his son Rehoboam, and he caused Rehoboam to take some bad advice. And of course, Rehoboam was becoming, he was a brand new king. He was the crowned prince, had just ascended the throne, son of Solomon. He's of the tribe of Judah. And of course, the old men come to him and say, be a little easier than our father, than your father Solomon. He chastised us with whips. And Solomon said, let me counsel with some of my teenage friends. And they came in and said, you're king now. You're tough. You're somebody. Show them who you are, Solomon. Tell them that you'll chastise them with scorpions. The scorpion was a predecessor of the Roman flagellum. It had pieces of glass and bone in it. And this, of course, may have been a figurative language that he was excessively hard on the people. And of course, the people said, so Solomon did that. He told the people, my father may have chastised you with whips. I'll chastise you with scorpions. And the people ran to Jeroboam and said, Jeroboam, rescue us from this maniac. And Jeroboam was the commanding general of the kingdom. Well, of course, Jeroboam goes north, takes the 10 northern tribes. This is the 10 northern tribes. Here's the two southern tribes of Judah. He takes the 10 northern tribes north, and then a prophet comes to Rehoboam and says, Rehoboam, this is of the Lord. Do not attack Jeroboam. So Rehoboam backs off, repents, and Jeroboam is afraid that the people will go back and turn to Rehoboam and go back and join southern Judah. So Jeroboam does something major. He says, I've got to do something. So he institutes golden calf worship and said, behold the gods that brought you out of Egypt. It is too much for you to go down there to worship with Rehoboam. So he starts something that all these kings keep in their kingdom. That Jeroboam, that golden calf worship, is like an official mark keeping the kingdom up here separated from southern Judah. So if you'll notice, as we study these kings, some of them, even we get into Jehoram, son of Ahab, and Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, Jehoram puts down the Baal of Ahab and puts down the grove or the tree goddess of Ahab and Jezebel, but he holds on to the golden calf or the sins of Jeroboam, because that's what keeps northern Israel separated from southern Judah. And any king who gives up Jeroboam's golden calf, that's giving up the reason for northern Israel to join south, and they're going to lose their kingdom. So most of these kings, Jehu does that. That's what disappointed me about Jehu, because Jehu was like, he was like Captain Marvel when I first read him. Superman, Batman, he's going over to kill Jezebel. Wonderful, isn't that great? And then he stays with the sins of Jeroboam. He does one of the greatest annihilations of the Baal worship in northern Israel, besides going up Jezreel to kill Jezebel. Well, we've come down through these guys here. They all hold on to the sins of Jeroboam, the golden calf, as we go down here. And in the book of the kings, we're dealing with, remember this, in the books of the kings, you're dealing with prophets, a view of the prophets. When we go into the books of Chronicles, you're dealing with a view from the priesthood. When you get into Chronicles, 1st and 2nd Kings and 1st and 2nd Chronicles, that is like Matthew, Mark, and Luke. Matthew, Mark, and Luke are synoptic gospels. They have a synonymous view of Scripture. 1st and 2nd Kings and 1st and 2nd, taking 1st and 2nd Kings in opposition to 1st and 2nd Chronicles, they actually blend together. So when we're studying 1st and 2nd Kings, we have to jump over and see how that 1st and 2nd Chronicles views this. So what we're doing is we're going down through these kings. We've gone down Nadab, son of Jeroboam. He only gets two verses in 1 Kings. That's it. He didn't last long, did he? Two verses. And then he's dead because Baasha, this guy's a killer. This Baasha is a devious, underhanded lowlife. In fact, he builds a wall. He builds the Iron Curtain, is what I call it. Or he builds the wall in Berlin. The Berlin Wall. He builds a Berlin Wall between northern Israel and southern Judah and says none of Asa's people can come north. Don't matter who you got up there, you can't come north. And of course, Asa goes out, and Asa was a good man. We come from Rehoboam to his son Abijah, his son Asa. And Asa was a pretty good man there in the 14th chapter of 2 Chronicles. But in the 16th chapter of 2 Chronicles, he goes and employs who else but Ben-Hadad to help him fight Baasha to bring down that wall that he had set up. And of course, each one of these guys, each one of these kings, southern Judah on the left, this is the proper king. Let me slow down. Southern Judah has what that they don't have in northern Israel? What do they have?
Priests.
Huh? Priests. Well, they do have some priests. Thank you, Mike. They've got Levites because all the Levites get out of there when Jeroboam sets up this golden calf. But what officially do they have down here that they don't have here? The king. They've got the real king in southern Judah. Southern Judah, because if you go where Jacob's gathered his sons around him in the 49th chapter of Genesis, and he starts blessing each one of his 12 sons in a row as they came, as they were born. Number one, Reuben. Number two, Simeon. Number three, Levi. And he gets down to the fourth one, Judah. He says, the scepter will not depart from Judah, nor a lawgiver from between his feet until Shiloh come. And unto Judah will the gathering of the people be. The king will come out of Judah, and the scepter will never depart from Judah. Well, of course, the left-hand side of this chart, that's Judah. And this is father, son, 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 son. It gets real confusing right here. Mother. That's Athaliah. She is the daughter of Ahab and Jezebel. Athaliah marries the son of Jehoshaphat, Jehoram. And of course, she is a murderess. She wants the kingdom for herself. Jehoshaphat hangs around with Ahab. Jehoshaphat's a good man. Ahab is a heathen. You can't hang around with the wrong people and not get dirty. If you hang around with the wrong people and try to convert somebody on Friday night that God won't deal with, and you have them over for a barbecue or for steaks, your son will look at their daughter and end up married, and all hell came to southern Judah in the form of this daughter from hell, Athaliah. She comes down to southern Judah. Her husband, Jehoram, dies. Ahaziah, her son, dies. She says, I want the kingdom for myself. So she kills all of her grandchildren, except one, Joash. And, of course, he's hidden until he's grown. And then he's brought out one day, and we've gone through his story. He's brought out one day, and they crown him king and say, God save the king. And Athaliah hears about it, and she says, treason, treason. To me, that's one of the funniest things in Scripture. That's kind of like Tokyo Rose or Mata Hari or Axis Sally or saying treason, or Lucretia Borgia. Treason! Yeah, I think that's funny. She's hollering treason, but of course they kill her before she says much else. And then Joash's son, Amaziah, son of Joash, Uzziah, son of Amaziah, Jotham, son of Uzziah. And it doesn't matter which ones of these guys are evil in southern Judah. God says, I will preserve them because of my promise. Northern Israel, it just depends on how strong you are if you're a good general. If you're Omri and you're head of the army, you'll just kill the guy before you, and so forth. Of course, Ahab was the son of Omri. If you're Jehu and God appoints you, you'll go out killing everybody he tells you to kill. But if you're in southern Judah, Uzziah's son was Jotham, Joseph's son was Ahaz, Ahaz's son was Hezekiah, Hezekiah's son was Manasseh, Hezekiah was righteous, Manasseh was evil, Manasseh's son was Ammon, Ammon was evil, Ammon's son was Josiah, great-grandson of Hezekiah, Josiah was righteous, Hezekiah was righteous, and David was righteous. That's all the righteous kings we had in Israel. Then you get on down to Jehoahaz, Jehoiakim, Jehoiachin, and Zedekiah. These three were brothers here, Zedekiah, Jehoiachin, and Jehoiakim. These were brothers, and one would die, and the other would be placed up in his place. And then all the way down to Jesus in the first chapter of Matthew. Now, we've been studying these. Each one of these men had a prophet. We talked about the different prophets of the different men. Rehoboam had a prophet named Shimei. Asa had a prophet named Hanani that came to him. And, of course, Ahab's prophet was... Does anybody remember who Ahab's prophet was? Huh? Now, you have to know who Ahab's prophet is. Elijah. Somebody said. Elijah is the one that went and stood before Ahab and Jezebel and said, there'll be no rain for 3.5 years. I'm out of here. And boy, they went after him to kill him. Well, the prophet was the mouth of God upon the earth. We've come down to Elijah. We're right in the midst of Jehoshaphat and Ahab's children. If you'll notice, Jehoshaphat, there in the 22nd chapter of 1 Kings, Jehoshaphat's righteous. He's a godly man. He's got one problem. He thinks he owes something to his pagan heathen brothers. He owes nothing to Ahab. And Ahab has a small army. He goes to Jehoshaphat and says, this Syrian king is about to attack me. Will you join me? Sure, you're my brother. I know you're a pagan and you brought Baal in the grove into Israel, but I love you. God loves everyone, and I love all my brothers. We ain't supposed to be doing that. I got a younger brother who's 55 years old, and he's up here at the Devil's Broadcasting Network, and he's no brother of mine if he doesn't do the will of God and crucify that hellishness he's into. My brothers and my sisters are those who do the will of Father, Jesus said. And that's who our brothers and sisters are. So we're talking about Jehoshaphat goes to the aid of Ahab. Since they hang around together, righteousness is hanging around with unrighteousness. Jehoshaphat does not make Ahab righteous. Ahab makes Jehoshaphat's family unrighteous. And of course, Jehoshaphat's son is Jehoram. And if you'll notice, Ahab's got two sons, Ahaziah and Jehoram. And Jehoshaphat's got a son named Jehoram. And Jehoram names his son Ahaziah. And they're intermarrying in in Israel, in southern Judah, northern Israel. Well, the Baal and the grove worship in the 16th chapter of 1 Kings, Baal being Hercules, or Mithra, whose birthday is December the 25th. The grove is Venus, is the Tyrian Venus, or Aphrodite, or whatever you want to call her, because they were all the tree goddesses of the ancient world, and that's what Israel became involved in, Aphrodite Ceres or Sibyl or Diana of the Ephesians. They were all the same, the tree goddesses. So Ahab brings that in, and Jehoshaphat runs around with him and goes to his aid, and Jehoram, his son, marries Ahab and Jezebel's daughter, Athaliah, and that brings Baal worship into southern Judah. That's how it bled down into southern Judah, and we'll get into that at the end of 2 Kings. Now, where we are right now, Elijah has gone out to be with God, gone out to meet God in the second chapter of 2 Kings. He's gone out in a great fiery chariot, and Elisha has taken his place. We've already gone through. We're talking about Elisha. But let me read to you something. I've got to read this to you. Very interesting words here. I've got to read this to you because it's so interesting. He's talking about how Jehoshaphat. In fact, let's look at this one more time. I've got to give this to you because this happens again here in the third chapter of 2 Kings. Go back to 1 Kings. 1 Kings, the 22nd chapter, and we see that 1 Kings 22nd chapter, I'm just going to read the first few verses, because Jehoram tries to do the same thing that his father-in-law Ahab, he's learning. Jehoram, son of Jehoshaphat, he marries Athaliah, daughter of Ahab and Jezebel. He's learning to make alliances with the wrong people. Let's look here in 1 Kings 22nd chapter. And they continued 3 years without war between Syria and Israel. Now look here. Syria is the old ancient enemies of God. These are the ancient enemies of God. Here is, if I got a map here. Well, I don't have a good handy map. I'll do this and then flip it over. Syria is directly above Israel, kind of northeast of Israel. Right above Israel is here on the eastern end of the Mediterranean. Here's Israel right here. Right above Israel is Lebanon. That's the old ancient system of Tyre and Sidon, and that's what married down into Israel, Ethbaal, who was the prince of Tyre, right about where Beirut, Lebanon is. That's right about where the old ancient city of Tyre was. And the prince of Tyre, his daughter comes down and marries the king of northern Israel. And he's equated in the 28th chapter, the prince of Tyre is equated with Satan. And he's a priest of the Ashtaroth in Babylon. He's a priest of Baal in Babylon. Syria is just north of Israel. The Assyrians were constantly attacking Israel. And it was said by the historians that there was a road built from Syria down on the western border of Israel, down here to that little brown spot. That is the Gaza Strip, or it's the old ancient land of the Philistines. The word Palestinian comes from the word Philistine. So there was a highway built down here. And if you'll notice, that's how part of the Syrians migrated down into this section of Israel in the ancient world. So the Palestinians are brothers. They are direct cousins or brothers to the Syrians. That's why when Assad before Hasad died, I believe it's a couple of years ago, he was the godfather of the Syrians, and whatever he says, all the Syrian world would do what he said, other than this maniacal brother over here, Saddam Hussein, and they had another wacky brother down here, Omar Gaddafi. But usually the world did what the Syrians said. And of course, the oldest city in the world is supposed to be Damascus. And they were always going to attack. They were out here attacking Israel, and they were direct brothers or relations to the Palestinians. Now, where was I? What was I doing? I was giving it for something. Huh? 22nd. Okay. So without war between Syria and Israel, they were constantly at war with Israel here. And it came to pass in the third year that Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, came down to the king of Israel. Now you got to understand, Israel is split. The king, it says here, that it came to pass in the third year that Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, came down to the king of Israel. What does it mean, come down to the king of Israel? Jehoshaphat comes down to Ahab, who is king of Israel. How can it be down when Jehoshaphat's king of Judah and Israel is northern Israel is north of Judah? How could it be down? That's because Judah is the highest elevation in that part of the world. So anytime you find that they're coming up to Jerusalem, even if they're coming from the north, the Bible always speaking of them coming up to Jerusalem. That's because Jerusalem had high elevation. So Jehoshaphat comes down to the king of Israel. And the king of Israel said unto his servants, know ye that Ramoth in Gilead is ours, and we be still, and take it not out of the hand of the king of Syria. And he said unto Jehoshaphat, wilt thou go with me to battle to Ramoth Gilead? This is Ahab saying to Jehoshaphat. First of all, what is Jehoshaphat doing visiting this evil king in northern Israel? What's he doing? If you'll notice these words, what's he doing even visiting Ahab? He just kind of felt a brotherly need to go and check in with his northern Israel brother, because he was king of southern Israel or southern Judah. And Jehoshaphat said to the king of Israel, oh man, what he says is, this is one of the most evil things that you can say as a believer to a man who is an unbeliever. I am just like you. I am as thou art, my people as thy people, and my horses as thy horses. What I have is yours, since you're my brother, since you're my pagan brother living godlessly. We're to come out and separate from them. It does not matter. Jesus said in Matthew, the 10th chapter and the 12th chapter of Luke, he said, I did not come to bring peace, but I came to bring a sword. And he said, it will divide father and son and mother and daughter and husband and wife. It'll divide you from your family when you start telling the truth. Don't say, I am as you are. Don't say, we're just alike. Let me read something to you. You know what that means? What they're saying, let me write it down on the board. What Jehoshaphat is saying, let's be friends under any condition. And he's saying to him, I know I don't believe what you believe, and you don't serve the God I serve, and you don't serve Jehovah God anymore, but you're an Israelite. That's like me going to my brother and say, well, you're a brown, so let's get along. Let's agree. Agree to disagree. No siree. Nope, don't like that word. Don't tell me to agree to disagree with you. Who do we agree with? Confess. If we confess Christ, confess does not mean, I'll say it one more time, does not mean to say with your lips, I believe in Jesus. I'd like to call this hotline and I'd like to confess Christ. It's not it. The word is homologeo, H-O-M-O-L-O-G-E-O. It comes from homo, meaning of the same, and the word logos. The word logos is the Greek word word. It means to be of the same word or to agree with. If we confess with our mouth the Lord Jesus, we agree with our mouth the same things that He said with His mouth. If He said, you have to take your cross and die, we say with our mouth, you have to take your cross and die. If He said, you have to be persecuted, we say, Jesus is right. You must be persecuted for righteousness' sake. If He says you have to be hated, we say you have to be hated. That's confessing Christ. If Paul says in Acts, over there in Acts 14, 22, we must through tribulation, much tribulation, enter the kingdom of God to confess Paul and to confess the word of God, we say we must through much tribulation enter the kingdom of God. Whatever Jesus said, that's what we say. We confess Christ and we agree with Him. We don't agree with the adversaries of God. Well, of course, Jehoshaphat goes into battle, and he does something that Mr. Edersheim brings out. I never really saw it before in Practical Truths in the Life of Elisha. He says he makes the decision to go into battle with an evil man because he thinks it's his brother. And then after he makes the decision to go into battle, then he decides to pray. Wait a minute. He decides to call on a prophet then and get the advice of God after he's already made the decision to go into battle. You don't make a decision before you pray. Say, I will become this. I'll go out here and do this work. And then I think I'll become a rich real estate agent. Then you go into it and then you say, now God help me to make lots of money. You pray before you go do what you do. Let me read this to you, what he says about Jehoshaphat, because in the third chapter of 2 Kings, Jehoram learns the same trick of trying to employ good men to come to his aid. Now look here. Let me read this to you. It was only after Jehoshaphat had entered upon that ill-fated expedition that it occurred to him to consult the Lord about its righteousness. It is strange how prone religious persons are to make alliance with the world. And that's what Jehoshaphat was doing, was making an alliance with Ahab. We're to come out and be separate and touch not the unclean thing. We're to have no fellowship with unfruitful works of darkness, but rather we are to reprove them. It sometimes seems as if we almost witnessed a race who should most readily abandon his principles. Men are so ready to abandon their principles as believers to get along with the world, aren't we? We want to get along. Wait a minute. James 4:4 says, whosoever be a friend of the world is the enemy of God. Friendship with the world is enmity against God. That word enmity, E-C-H-T-H-R-A, that word ekthra means hostile. If you can get along with the world and vote, and you can get the vote, and you're friends with everybody that comes along, you mean I'm supposed to be mean to everybody? No, you can be cordial to people, but you're not to be eating with people. You're not to be fellowshipping with people. That's one thing that the Christ Mass does. You're supposed to feel obligated to go to some Christmas dinner where half of the people or most of the people are heathens and nobody's talking about Jesus. Not only is an alliance accepted, but it is in these terms. I am as thou art, my people as thy people. God forbid that this should prove true, that you're just like that pagan Ahab. I am not like my little brother up there at TBN at all. I don't believe anything like he believes. And he doesn't believe like I believe at all, and we can't even have a civil conversation, because I will correct him. I'll say, Dean, you are a crook and a thief, and if you don't quit stealing from the poor, God said, if you oppress the poor, and he said, they cry unto me, I'll hear their cry, and I'll kill you with a sword. That's what I tell my brother. I don't like it when I got a blood brother a literal brother from the same flesh that's cheating and lying and stealing from the people. If you think I won't tell him that, I'll tell him at the drop of a hat. Because I told my mother and father, a Baptist preacher and the organist piano player, the last time I saw him, I told both of them, you have to repent. You have to come to a hard place before you tell your parents that. On these points, he says, but all such compromises arise from this mistake. The more dangerous, because practical and not theoretical, that religion and everyday life can be separated. We have our own principles, so it is argued, and others have their views. So we say, he's got his view and I got my view. There need be no collision. That's what men say. On these points, we may agree to differ. A saying which may be ranked among these spacious platitudes by which the great enemy has deceived and injured so many. What? Agree to differ? On what subject? Whether Jehovah or Baal is God? Is that what you're going to agree on? I believe Jehovah's God and you believe Baal is God. Okay, well, let's get along. No! Yes, we shall differ, but never agree to differ on this point till our faithfulness and strength have disappeared under the insidious influence of slow but certain spiritual poison. That's what it'll bring in your life. When you agree to disagree with somebody, know that puts you in an agreeable situation with them. Oh, I will disagree with them, but I will not agree to disagree. It reminds me of Hebrews, the 6th chapter. I've heard preachers say, well, let's agree to disagree. No, you're not going to get that from me. I will agree with God. I will not do what Jehoshaphat did. Except for the grace of God, I will not go to an Ahab. Say, well, let's get along. I know you believe Baal is God, and I believe Jehovah is God. No. And a lot of these preachers out here who won't preach the truth, they believe their God because they don't really believe in a sovereign God who's in charge of everything. Look at Hebrews. Look at Hebrews 6th chapter. Love this verse. Love this Hebrews 6th chapter. And this is what Jehoshaphat did, and this is what they did often when they would try to go and make some kind of league with the world. Look here in Hebrews the 6th chapter. Verse 16, for men verily swear by the greater, an oath for confirmation is to them an end to all strife, wherein God, willing more abundantly to show unto the heirs of promise the immutability of his counsel. Now that word immutability tells you where you're supposed to stand with God. Here's the word immutability, A, M-E-T-A. T-H-E-T-O-S. Ametathetos. That word ametathetos is a word that means to reckon. It comes from the alpha privative and the word meta, T-H-E-T-O-S. Metathetos means to reconcile differences. When you reconcile your differences, it means to draw together differences. When you draw together your differences with other people, you are agreeing to disagree. You say, let's pull our differences together. God says, my counsel is immutable. When you place the alpha privative in front of metathetos, it means no reconciling differences. I will not do that. God says, I will not agree to disagree with you. Of course, it comes from meta, meaning to accompany, and tithame means to level in a passive horizontal posture. God said, I will not level in fellowship with your doctrine. I will not agree with you. Metatithame means to level, to accompany someone else. God says, I will not agree to disagree, and that's what Jehoshaphat did. And that's what we do, don't we? When we want to go and run around with the wrong people and run around with people who don't believe God, and we won't. I want to disagree with a man, but I won't agree to disagree with him. Because when you agree to disagree, then you agree to get along with him and have a disagreement and keep it quiet. No. And I'm afraid that's what... Let me finish reading this. May we not go further and with sadness at heart say that the meanness and even the sins of which Christian men and women are sometimes guilty in entering in upon such an alliance are, to put it in modern language, in agreeing to differ. He says, that's the modern language. You know when he wrote this book? He was born in 1825 and he died before 1900. He called modern language agreeing to disagree before the 1890s. He said, modern language says, let's agree to differ. See, that's been going on a long time. And Edersheim said, let's don't ever do that. But really, in lowering themselves and abandoning their principles in order to take... He says, the reason men abandon their principles and abandon the Word of God in becoming friends of the world in trying to get along, it's in order to take notice. It's order to be taken notice of by the world. They want to be noticed by the world. They want the world to like them. That's when Christians abandon their principle, like Jehoshaphat. He wanted to be liked by Ahab. Who cares if Ahab likes you? You want your boss to like you? The guy's a pagan. He drinks. He takes drugs. He runs around on his wife. And just because he owns a company, you want him to like you? He's a heathen. They want this in order to be taken notice by the world and worldly society. This is amazing. He said this in the 1800s. He said in the 1800s, before we had the big super society we have today, or mainly the reasons of a diminished spiritual life. He said the reason your life is spiritually diminished is you want to be noticed by the world and worldly society, and you want people to like you. That's what it is. That's why people turn away from God, which we mourn in the church. The mischief may not spring from a deeper source than the weakness of a Jehoshaphat. That's all there is. He said it's Jehoshaphat is weak. Let me say this. I love this next sentence. I've talked about how people have left Grace and Truth Ministries along the way, and how that a lot of people will come up and get mad at Jim Brown. They come up with a reason to get mad at Jim Brown, because I believe back in the back of their mind, after 2 or 3 years of this hard message of having to face their family and having to face their boss and having to face people about Christmas year after year after year and having to face self-denial and having to face a daily cross, he says it in this next sentence. We are afraid to appear singular. We're afraid to appear alone by ourselves in the world, facing the world alone like Elijah, like Elisha, like Paul, like Jesus, when they were chasing Paul all over the country trying to kill him. We don't want to appear singular. When people, I wrote this at the top of the page, when people don't want to be singular or alone, standing against the world, it is because they do not have enough spiritual strength, and that comes from studying the Word. It comes from fire. That's what makes a man stand. Until you study the Word, people are led away by winds of doctrine because something sounds good and because they want to get along with those people. And what keeps a man from knowing right doctrine from wrong doctrine, he's weak. The Bible says that the innocent, the simple are the ones that are deceived. The word simple there in Romans 16, 17, and 18, by good words and fair speeches, they deceive the hearts of the simple. Only the uneducated, simple-minded person, the baby, the 7-year-old, the 8-year-old, the baby believer will be led away because they're not founded in the Word. A man can't stand alone. He can't stand by himself unless he is super strong. That's how do you think Elijah stood against 450 prophets of Baal? By himself. He said, I know God is right. I've said this and I will say this without any qualms. If I could go down here and sit down in the Delphi Coliseum or whatever they call it right now and put Billy Graham and Charles Stanley and Ed Young and Adrian Rogers and all these big famous Southern Baptist preachers in a row behind one table on one side of the table and down at the end put Kenneth Copeland, Fred Price, and Oral Roberts, I would sit down on one side of the table and say, if you guys don't behave yourself and if you do not quit preaching your lies, you're all going to die in your sin and go to hell. Let me tell you, it takes strength to do that. And you know what the strength is? It's not just boldness and a loud voice that does it. It is years and years and years of fire and study of the Word, but I guarantee you I would look at him and say that. So you're all lying about the sovereignty of God, about predestination. You're out here and you got your Christ mass. And Adrian Rogers, you got a great big huge Christ mass tree in your pulpit every year. You should be ashamed of yourself. To stand one against the world, it's not because I am loud. I am loud. That doesn't have anything to do with it. I'm a driven, forceful kind of personality, but that's not it. If I was not positively, absolutely sure of this word and what it says when it comes to what they're preaching, I couldn't do it. But I would do that. I would stand. I have called preachers down in this town face to face and say, Mister, that's God's flock. You call them to repentance. There is a boldness you can have when you know the word, but men can't stand singular because they're not founded. And they get led off by winds of doctrine. That's what makes you strong is the more you learn. He goes on to say, we wish to occupy our proper place. We must be like our neighbors. This is a mob mentality. That's what Jehoshaphat was wanting to do. He wanted Ahab and all of Israel to like him. He wanted to be liked. But it destroyed his family. I mean, looky there. Jehoshaphat, a wonderful man. Asa, a wonderful man at one time. Jehoshaphat's son marries a woman that kills all of his grandson's children. All of Jehoshaphat's great-grandchildren were killed except one because he ran around with Ahab. Was that ruining your family? I guess so. Our business, listen to what Edersheim says. Our business requires conformity to the world. He wrote this in the 1800s. That sounds like 2002, doesn't it? You know why? The truth of sin never changes as well as the truth of the Bible. Our business requires conforming to the world. If your business requires conforming to the world, change business. But I'm afraid that's everything you're in unless you take a stand and say, you'll have to do with me as you please. Here's what I believe. And I'm going to stand on it. But if indeed spiritual things have been a reality to us, if we have fled for refuge to the hope set before us in the gospel, if we have been purchased with the precious blood of Jesus, if we have laid up our treasure in heaven, let us consider and see what we are doing when thus identifying ourselves with the world as we go to the ballroom or the theater. Now, that's the only thing he could say. He didn't have drugs back then. Didn't have the movies back then. He didn't have all the entertainment back then. He just said the ballroom or the theater. Are we not in very deed surrendering our most cherished principles by such associations? And how many times have I preached on coming out and being separate and separating from the world because the world is going to get us dirty? He goes on to say, nor did Jehoshaphat on that occasion intend to go without the Lord. He didn't intend to go without the Lord. Jehoshaphat, when he went and Ahab asked him to join him, before he marched to the battlefield, he would inquire at the word of Jehovah. But he didn't inquire at the word of Jehovah whether he should go to the battlefield with a pagan. That's the point. Before you start taking off and making a decision in some direction, pray about the direction first. But instead of seeking such direction before he went to Samaria, he just decided to go up and visit Ahab in Samaria. I think I'll go visit my pagan brother. I stay away from my pagan brother. I got an older brother, Clyde. He seems to be tenderhearted if I can get him away from his wife. I'd like to get Clyde aside and say, Clyde, listen to me. I got him at my house one time, and I started talking predestination. He started looking at me, and he was my big brother, and he used to defend me when I was little and beat the big guys up that picked on me. He's looking at me, he said, and I was talking about predestination. He said, Jimmy, I think I could believe that. And his wife said, we don't believe that, and just yanked it away and yanked the conversation somewhere. And that's the last chance I had to talk to him. Instead of seeking such direction before he went to Samaria, ask it after he had gone. After he had already made his decision without asking the will of God, he waited till he went up there to see his pagan brother. And then when he's up there, his brother said, would you go to war with me? He didn't pray about whether he should go see his pagan brother who believed Baal was God and he believed Jehovah was God. He asked it after he had gone, and when consequently it was too late. We also too often consult the Lord only after we determine our own course. We determine our course and then we say, God, I'd like to pray to you about this as I pursue all this money. And you know what this has done to me in the last 2 days? In the last 2 days, this has convicted my heart. I have been as guilty of this as anybody I know. It is, Mr. Edersheim, sometimes I look at his book and I'm going, how does he see these things? And I just sit back in amazement, going, how did he see that? I didn't see that. I've read through that so many times I can't count. And I didn't even notice that Jehoshaphat decided to go visit his pagan brother, who was not his literal brother, but he was an Israelite. And then we kneeled down to pray. Surely not for direction, because we've already determined our direction, haven't we? But for success in what we have already chosen without asking God. This is to ask amiss that we may consume it on our own lust. Because when we've made the decision without consulting God, and then we head for our dreams, and God cuts us off on the way there, and we say, wait a minute, God, I want to ask you about this as I pursue this $1 million. I've done that. Have you done that? Have you done that? Gerald, I know you've done that. You've told me you've done that. Yeah. To desire an Ahab to inquire at the word of the Lord was but another, though a consistent, token of weakness on the part of Jehoshaphat. He wanted an Ahab in his life because he just wanted people to like him. Ahab consulted the prophets of Baal, and of course, all 400 of them said with one accord, go up. Look at that in 1 Kings 22. Look down here in verse 6. Now, 450 prophets of Baal have already been killed on Mount Carmel, but this is another 400 prophets of Baal. This ain't the same ones that's been killed over there. If you remember over there when he faces the 400 prophets of Baal in chapter 18, 450, Elijah kills them, but this is another set of them. Then the king, verse 6 of chapter 22, 1 Kings, then the king of Israel gathered the prophets together, about 400 men, and said unto them, shall I go against Ramoth Gilead to battle, or shall I forbear? And they said, go up. Go on. We're prophets of Baal, and we know what's good for you. Go up and win the battle. For the Lord shall deliver it into the hand of the king. What a bunch of liars. Sounds like a bunch of preachers, doesn't it? Yes, go and win. Let me finish reading. I love this chapter in this book. It's convicted my heart, and I want to share it with you. What it has caused me to realize, at times I've wanted I've wanted a building without consulting God. I've wanted more TV stations, more radio stations without saying, God, what do you will? God, I will try my best to do all I can do. Guide me as I do this. And Lord, do these things in your time because he's got it arranged. I have learned something from Mr. Edersheim in these last few days. I need to pray about everything before I approach anything. Because we get so presumptuous, as Jehoshaphat did. I'll head this way and I'll go visit my pagan brother. And then when I get there, my brother's going to say, would you like to join me in this? And I'm going, well, yeah, let me pray as we go towards it. First of all, he shouldn't have gone to visit Ahab. Secondly, when he got there, when Ahab says, would you go to battle with me? He should have said, no, I'm going home. You're a heathen. That should have been his answer. Because Ahab died in the battle anyway, didn't he? Let me read this. The ill-fated battle of Ramoth-Gilead had led to most serious consequences for the kingdom of Israel. No sooner had tidings of the defeat and death of Ahab reached Moab than its king, hitherto tributary to Israel, resolved to cast off his allegiance. Now, possibly the circumstance that Jehoram had put away the image of Baal. Let's go over there. Let me show you something. Now, in 1 Kings 22, if you'll notice, at the end of that chapter, verse 46, and the remnant of the Sodomites, which remained in the days of his father Asa, he took out of the land. There was then no king in Edom. A deputy was king. Jehoshaphat made ships of Tarshish to go to Ophir for gold, but they went not, for the ships were broken at Ezion-Geber. Then said Ahaziah, the son of Ahab, unto Jehoshaphat. Ahab's dead. Now, this is what amazes me about Jehoshaphat. Let my servants go with thy servants in the ships. But Jehoshaphat turned him down because he realized he had done wrong with Ahab. But Ahaziah dies. Ahaziah, verse 51, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel in Samaria in the 17th year of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and reigned 2 years over Israel. Then in the next chapter, the first chapter of 2 Kings, this Ahaziah dies. And I want you to watch. Jehoshaphat goes and joins Ahab, but he refuses to go with his son, because God evidently has taught him a lesson. But then when the brother of Ahaziah becomes king in the third chapter, what does Jehoshaphat do? He accepts Ahab. He refuses Ahaziah because he sees that Ahab dies. But in the third chapter of 2 Kings, Jehoram tries to invite him. Why do these three kings, Ahab, Ahaziah, and Jehoram, want Jehoshaphat on their side? It's kind of like I had a friend in music business. Let me not call him a friend. I had an associate, an acquaintance in the music business. He was always cheating and lying and stealing. But when he wanted somebody to believe him, he would come and get me and say, now, Jim won't lie to you. Isn't that right, Jim? You know, Jim's a Christian. And here I am mixed up with this mess, with this guy who lies and cheats and steals. And I'm in business. I'm saying, no, he's right on this time. He's not lying this time. And that's what's happening with... Have I hung around with people like that? I nearly got in prison hanging around a guy like that in the music business. And it's long stories. He nearly got me through in jail many times, and not just jail, but in prison. I'll tell you about it after church. But Jehoshaphat goes with Ahab, then he won't go with Ahaziah, and then in the third chapter, Jehoram asks Jehoshaphat to go with him, and he goes. He can't make up his mind whether he wants to separate from the world or not. He runs around with the father and the two sons. The one son he won't, probably because it's too recent. And there's a reason. Let's go over there, the third chapter of 2 Kings. It's utterly amazing. Is this guy, Jehoshaphat, is a good man, but he's got a weakness. And I can identify with him because this guy that I used to hang around in music, I used to think, well, I'll hang around him and I'll convince him and I'll witness to him all the time and I'll sing with him and I'll work with him and I'll be in this booking agency with him and we'll do these things and somehow I'll convince him. And you know what happened? I got filthy.
Yeah, that's right.
Yeah. I got in more trouble than I can explain to you. Just simply by association, I was there when he was breaking laws, big laws, felonies. And I was there putting my approval on it, and I could have got stuck in prison. By association. I know what Jehoshaphat did because I did it, and by the grace of God, I will not do that again. And you know what? I wanted to be this guy's friend because he was great personality, and he was always hustling, always making things happen, and you've seen him. And he's bragged on by everybody down in Nashville. Oh, this guy's great. Boy, he's going to either whip the world or end up in prison. He ended up in prison.
Got an angle.
Huh? He has an angle every day of his life. I was talking to him. And you know what? He can't even get out of my conversation. And I even told my wife, I said, man, he's slick. He's one of the slickest people I ever knew. He can talk his way out of prison. He's just that good. He makes everybody in prison like him. Makes the warden like him. He said, let's let him out. And he would slick me. I can tell you stories this high on him. And all of Nashville knew who he was back when he was hot. And he's still out there hustling. I said, Mary, he's in his 60s and he's still hustling and he ain't wore out and he can't get tired of it. What's wrong? Is he nuts? And I can't be around him and I don't want to get close to him. And I knew a bunch of those guys, but he just happened to be my close acquaintance. He was my Ahab. That's what he was. And he got me in a heap of trouble. Had one district attorney call me, told me if I didn't get certain monies back to Illinois, they were going to put me in prison. Money he took on some bookings I made, he switched the bookings and gave them to somebody else and said, I'm sorry, the money's spent. Do what you want. So I had to go dig up the money and send it back. And when you hang around Ahab, you get in trouble. I have been there. Let me read this. Let's get over here in the third chapter of 2 Kings. Jehoram, the son of Ahab. Here he is right here. Son of Ahab, Ahaziah's his brother. He's king. And he's going to go and recruit Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat's character, he's a Christian character, but you know what? So was I for a lot of years. You know what it was about? I can tell you exactly what Jehoshaphat wanted in Ahab. The same thing that I wanted. I had this great big pretty voice at one time, and I wanted a piece of the action. And I was willing to turn my head away to get everybody to like me. And maybe they'll put me up here and maybe I'll make my way up. If I keep my head turned when somebody's into dope or into cocaine or running around their wives, keep my head turned away and pretend it's not going on. I wanted position and money and I wanted the world to like me. So I hung around Ahab. Have you ever hung around Ahab? Ahab will get you in trouble. Now, if you've ever been in music, There's lots of Ahabs in music. They'll get you in trouble. And they got an angle every time they turn around. And some of them are so good, it's unbelievable. They're good. This guy is good. I mean, I've known con men. I've known some that thought they were good and they were con artists, but they're amateurs upside some of these guys. And slick and fast talking, and that's Ahab. You think that's exactly what he was? He could not convince all these people to keep following him if he wasn't slick.
And they get better by doing it.
Huh?
They get better by doing it.
Oh, they get better by doing it. You do it for 40 years and you're so good, it's hard to catch you, and you learn all the ins and outs. Let's read this. Jehoram, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel in Samaria. And it was during the 18th year of Jehoshaphat. Jehoram, the son of Ahab's dead. Ahaziah's dead. Jehoram is alive. And Jehoshaphat's been reigning in Israel for 18 years. Now, Jehoshaphat wants Ahab's attention. He wants him to like him. What does Ahab want from Jehoshaphat? Jehoshaphat's got a great army. What did this guy in the music business want from me? I could really hustle, and I could hustle honest. It applies to me so much, I just have to give a personal testimony. We were sitting out at Houston's restaurant one night, and this guy, he just talked real fast, slick real fast, and he just stopped one night, and he looked over at me and said, I booked in Vegas, and I booked in Los Angeles, and he said, I have never had anybody work with me that can book talent like you do. He said, I've never seen anybody do it. I could hustle. I had an army of super energy and hustle, and he knew that. That's what Ahab knew about Jehoshaphat. I could move, and I could sit on the phone for 16 hours just dialing as fast as I can. Just talk and talk real fast and say, yeah, I got this date. Give me them date sheets, and I'm just piling up dates on all these stars. And he said, you can really hustle. See, I had something that Ahab wanted. I wonder what this guy would think if he knew I was calling him Ahab. Maybe I ought to send him one of these tapes. Let's read on. Jehoram, the son of Ahab, began to reign over Israel and Samaria, the 18th year of Jehoshaphat, king of Judah, and reigned 12 years. And Jehoram wrought evil in the sight of the Lord, but not like his father and like his mother. His father's Ahab, his mother's Jezebel. You're going to have a hard time working that kind of evil. For he put away the image of Baal that his father had made. But that's not going to make him righteous. He's holding on to the golden calf. And beside that, he's a sissy and a pansy and he's gutless. He's a coward. And he presumes so much. Nevertheless, he cleaved unto the sins of Jeroboam, the son of Nebat. He keeps the golden calf. He wants Israel. Drop that, and northern Israel will unite with southern Judah. Which made Israel to sin, he departed not thereof. And Mesha, king of Moab, was a sheepmaster, and rendered unto the king of Israel 100,000 lambs, and 100,000 rams with the wool. But it came to pass, when Ahab was dead, that the king of Moab doesn't like being a vassal king, and he doesn't like to be under the rule of Israel anymore, and he rebels against Ahab, king of northern Israel. And so Jehoram, who is king of Israel, he doesn't have the pull with the king of Moab. And King Jehoram went out of Samaria, northern Israel, the same time, and numbered all of Israel. Now, it was against God's law to number Israel for the sake of just numbering them to show your power. But this is not the same word that God used with David in the 24th chapter of 2 Samuel. This word means to muster or review troops. He was mustering them together to go to war against Moab, because Moab has been a satellite or a vassal king of Israel an under king, a inferior king. Israel is ruling Moab. Moab is what we call southern Jordan. It's right. I've shown this to you before. Here's Moab, and Moab is under the rule of northern Israel. Now, and King Jehoram went out of Samaria the same time, numbered all Israel. And he went and sent to Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, saying, King of Moab has rebelled against me. I need your help. And Jehoram, it doesn't mean that he's righteous simply because he has put down Baal in the grove. He's still holding on to the golden calf. And the guy is one of the most gutless, nothing kings in all of Israel. Jehoram, the oldest son of Ahab, tries to recruit Jehoshaphat, and he's learning from his father. Jehoshaphat had already been rebuked by Jehu for helping Ahab. I got to show you that. Between when he helped Ahab in the 22nd chapter of 1 Kings, in the third chapter, there's a rebuke that comes from Jehu. Look at that in 2 Chronicles. You know what? Jehoshaphat is a very confused believer. Very confused because evidently he's not strong enough. He believes in God, and he has men going around teaching the law of God around Israel, but he can't seem to get a hold of this himself. He keeps mixing with the world. Look here in 2 Chronicles. Now, this 2 Chronicles 19, the time period of 2 Chronicles 19 happens in Chronicles. You've got to balance this. Let me write this on the board this way so that you'll see it. Let me put it up here like this. This will help you. Let me put time period or time factor. Time factor, 1 Kings 22, that's where Ahab recruits Jehoshaphat. 2 Kings 3, that's where Jehoram recruits Jehoshaphat. In 2 Kings 22, Jehoshaphat refuses Ahaziah. Between these right here, 2 Chronicles 19, 1 and 2. Now explain to me why this Jehoshaphat, let me tell you, Jehoshaphat's a picture of the weak Christian is what he is. Loves God, don't have any idea how he's supposed to be mixing in his life, how he's not supposed to be mixing. So you got the time factor of 2 Kings 19, 1 and 2 coming between these two in 1st and 2nd Kings, between 1st Kings 22nd chapter, where Ahab dies when he recruits Jehoshaphat to go war with the Syrians, and then he refuses to go with Ahaziah, but then he assents to go with Jehoram in 2nd Kings 3, but Jehu in 2nd Chronicles 19 rebukes Jehoshaphat. Jehoshaphat is a good man of God, but he doesn't know that he can't hang around with the wrong people and say, I am as you are, I'm the same as you are, because you're my brother. Jehoshaphat didn't realize the doctrine of Christ when Jesus said, my brothers and my sisters are those who do the will of God, and that's not Ahab. Look here. 19. 18 is the same corresponding chapter in 2 Chronicles. Well, let me just put this up here. 2 Chronicles 18 18 is the same corresponding chapter with the same story as 1 Kings 22. So immediately after this, he's rebuked. Jehu rebukes Jehoshaphat. And I'm bringing this out about Jehoshaphat so you can see how we're not supposed to be acting. It seems really difficult for Jehoshaphat to get this thing right. And I believe it's because he doesn't know enough about the Word of God. He wants to be dedicated to Christ, but he wants to run around with who he wants to. But look here at 19:1 and 2. After Jehoshaphat comes back from this battle with Ahab against Ben-Hadad, king of Syria, Jehoshaphat, the king of Judah, returned to his house in peace to Jerusalem. And Jehu, the son of Hanani, the seer, went out to meet him and said to King Jehoshaphat, "Shouldest thou help the ungodly?" Now, you would think he'd remember this when Jehoram is going to try to get him to go to war against Moab, wouldn't you? Wouldn't you think he'd remember that? "Should you help the ungodly and love them that hate the Lord?" He's talking about Ahab. Are you supposed to love the ungodly and help them and love those who hate God? "Therefore is the wrath upon thee from before the Lord." This rebuke came before 2 Kings, the third chapter. Now let's read. If there's an illustration of how we are not to live, it is Jehoshaphat. He had the right desires. He loved God, but he was weak when it came to his associations in the world. Let me read what Mr. Edersheim says. "Possibly the circumstance that Jehoram had put away the image of Baal may have seemed to Jehoshaphat sufficient warrants for an alliance." Well, he quit drinking. My friend quit drinking. Well, he still cusses and still chases women, but he quit drinking. That's enough, isn't it? He's trying. Huh? That's a start. "Perhaps Jehoshaphat thought it was sufficient warrants for an alliance, especially on political grounds. The success of Moab might prove a dangerous example to Edom. We always readily persuade ourselves to see a religious duty." So he's thinking, here's Jehoshaphat thinking, "Perhaps the success of Moab might prove dangerous for Edom, so we need to put down Moab, and I need to go with my enemies to put down Moab so as to, let's vote for the lesser of two evils." No, let's don't. Let's separate from it. I don't vote in America anymore. I'm not voting for a rattlesnake and a, give me a choice between a cobra and a black mamba, a Republican or a Democrat. They'll both get you. "We always are ready to persuade ourselves to see a religious duty where it is in our interest or pleasure to find it. How often, for example, when an unequal marriage or any similar alliance is about to be made, do we speak of hopeful signs?" Well, he's hopeful, and I think there's hope in him. We know that he gave up Baal in the grove, and we know he still goes after the golden calf, and we know he's a pansy and worthless. But there's hope because he gave that up. Do we do that to our friends? We're not supposed to be doing that. "Such as respect for religion or religious training, when after all there is no evidence of real religion than in the case of Jehoram." It's as though Jehoram, well, he's going to a seminary. Where is it? Vanderbilt Divinity School? Oh. Vanderbilt Divinity School, you might as well go to Hell's College. There ain't nothing out there. They believe God is a she out there. Yeah. They don't believe in the virgin birth. But he's going to Divinity School, Jehoram is. Again, let me just, this is good. "Men flatter the great or those to whom advantage binds them." They want advantage, and advantage binds them. and they discover marks of piety where the most large-hearted charity would have failed to discover any had not self-interest or inclination be put there. He's saying, you won't find it there unless it's yourself. You won't find any righteousness in an Ahab or in a Jehoram unless you put it there because of your self-interest, and your inclination has put you there because of self-advantage. Reminds me of a verse in Judah, in Jude. Look at Jude. Go over here, Jude. Look here. And here's why people, this is why we hang around. That's why I hung around this Ahab in the music business. Because I knew he was hanging around the big stars all the time, and he had the advantage, and I wanted a piece of his action. And I knew he always had the ability to get on close to somebody who had lots of money and lots of power. And I wanted it. Have you ever been like that? I know Bob has, because that's what music is about. I'm sorry, but that's what real estate's about, and so is insurance. And so is the legal business. Look here. Look here. He's speaking of these evil men, these men of old ordained to this condemnation in verse 4, and he's still talking about them. They're raging. In fact, if you look, these are spots on the Feast of Charity in verse 12. When they feast with you, feeding themselves without fear, clouds they are without water, carried about with winds, trees whose fruit withereth without fruit, twice dead, plucked up by the roots. They're raging waves of the sea, foaming out their own shame. This chapter is a sister chapter to chapter 2 of 2 Peter. Wandering stars, to whom is reserved the blackness of darkness forever. He's talking about these same men in verse 16. These are murmurers, complainers, walking after their own lust, and their mouth speaks great swelling words. They're con artists. Having men's persons in admiration because of advantage. They admire men because of the advantage that they can get from them. And these men are speaking great swelling words. I think that's what you would call these guys, these con artists in music. Right, Bob? They're con men. I think it's the same thing you call them in real estate. And greasy, huh? They are greasy, aren't they? Huh? Politicians, that's it, politics. So men want them for advantage. I am guilty. And God's forgiven me for that. This chapter just kind of knocked me out when I read it. This has convicted my heart. For a 2 Peter, the second chapter, it reads just basically the same. Mm-hmm. Let me finish reading this. This is so good. How often, for example, when an unequal marriage, we talk about giving in marriage, that's marrying truth to a lie, or any similar alliance is about to be made, do we speak of hopeful signs in somebody? Well, he's hopeful. Jehoram is hopeful. He's given up Baal in the grove, but he's a pansy and a sissy, and he don't believe God. And he's gutless. And he accuses God later in this chapter of bringing them into this situation to destroy him, and it was his idea to go. And then he says, men flatter the great, are those to whom advantage binds them. Advantage will bind you somebody in life because you're trying to get a piece of the action. That's what it'll do. And discover marks of piety where the most large-hearted charity would have failed to discover had not self-interest or inclination put it there. And I will confess, I've told the story to some of you, but I had this group. We sang good. It was really good. I mean, it's a great singing group. Harmony was great. The show was great. And I wanted to be famous in the music world. I wanted to get to the top of the world. And I wanted advantage. And I was inclined because of my desire. And my manager was my father at the time, and he was a hustler. And I said, Daddy, let me tell you what we need to do. We need to go to Vegas. And this is the kind of trouble it'll get you into. I said, we got to go into Vegas in the big showrooms. I said, we've got the show to do it with. Everywhere we go in these colleges, and they all say this is super show. He said, I can get us in Vegas. And I had forgotten something. And I wanted the advantage. And I thought, how can he get us in Vegas? And Vegas is run by the mafia. And my father's sister was married to one of Bugsy Siegel's associates. And I knew how we were going to get into Vegas. But do you realize where that would have put me? And my father went to Vegas, and I said, we need to be in the Flamingo or one of the big showrooms. He went to Vegas, and I wanted Ahab. The first day he got in Vegas, he got into Bill Miller's office. He's one of the biggest promoters in Vegas. You know how he did that? He dropped the name Bugsy Siegel. My father was a Baptist preacher, dropping Bugsy Siegel, and he said, my sister is Nettie Capri. He was married to your partner, Mr. Capri. She was married to your partner. And he said, we will go in there, that's no doubt. But I would have been tied to the mafia. And God caused this super show act to blow up in my face right before we were going out there for so many weeks he had booked us. I wouldn't have been here. I've been dead somewhere because I wouldn't have done what they said. And it is controlled by them. He said, oh, I have no problem. That's exactly what we're talking about here. When you do something for advantage, do you think I wouldn't do that? Do you think I'm not a sinner? I'm as big a sinner as you'll find. I wanted fame and fortune and money at one time. And I was willing to compromise and go play around with Ahab to get it. I wanted Ahab to love me. Have you been there? And you know, it scares me to death to realize that. I mean, look what happened to Bugsy Siegel. Just shot him all to pieces. And when I was in music, I would hear about, we had offices down on Music Row, and we'd hear about some guy get thrown off the top of the 4-star building, or some old rock and roll star getting shot in some club, or I heard about one rock star that the mafia said, you will go and you will play in this club down in Louisiana, down to the bottom of Louisiana, and you will sit there till we tell you to move. And if you don't and you owe them, you die. Don't matter how famous you were when you were a rock star. When you want a piece of the action, you're like Jehoshaphat. I'm just giving a little personal testimony. I understand Jehoshaphat here. I understand that he wanted Ahab to like him. I've wanted Ahab to like me. Everybody. There's no temptation taken me but such as is common to you. And when you want somebody to like you, and that's why you compromise and give up. I'm beginning to understand something, that God really does have things in control. And when God dealt with me, he had to teach me, I will supply your needs wherever you are and whatever you're doing. There was a time I was so in love with my vocal abilities, there's no way I would have quit. What do you mean, quit music? I'll never quit that. Never. But I was weak. I was always trying to run around with Ahab. And let me tell you, they got a whole bunch of Ahabs in that business. They got a whole bunch of them in every business that's out there. I mean, sure, I'm sure we've all kept our mouths shut in somewhere in our businesses because we're afraid we're going to lose the action, and that's what Jehoshaphat wanted. It's about self. It's about, I want comfort. I want to be at the top. I want the power. I want the money. I want the prestige. And it's the same thing in banking, isn't it, Mike? Mike was in New York in banking, and he said, it's insane. And you had to play the game with an Ahab to get to the top of banking, didn't you, Mike? It don't matter where you are. Huh? Boy, if you get to the top of something, you're in trouble with God. I've run out of time. I may just make copies of the chapter. This has influenced me as much as anything I've ever read by Alfred Edersheim, because it's one of the most practical truths of living when he's talking about, I just read this to you. Alliance cannot be made with the world on other terms than I am as thou art. That's how you make an alliance. I am as you are. We cannot go so far and then withdraw. It doesn't work. Once you're in, you're in. When we are making such a compromise, let us not deceive ourselves by arguing that otherwise we might repel a hopeful beginning and so drive men further from the gospel. But in order to be consistent, it is not necessary to be disagreeable or unkind. You can still be kind, but don't get into their game. You do, you're in trouble. Let's pray. Father, thank you for this practical lesson. God, we've all made deals with Ahab, just like Jehoshaphat. God, it's destroyed a great part of my life, and I don't ever want to do that again. I don't agree with any man for any reason that would go against your word. Teach us all here to pray before we go, before we even make a decision to go to our brother Ahab. He may be our brother in the flesh, but he's not spiritual if he doesn't believe you. Let us be careful what we do when we do this. This has so convicted my heart, God. I thank you for Mr. Edersheim. He's long dead, and he doesn't know the effect he's having today on this little Bible teacher. Thank you for this word of truth. Forgive us of our sin, and you fight our battles. Let us not recruit evil men to fight them for us. Forgive us of our sin in Christ's name. Amen.